You said, I've never been more confident in Google than I am today. What made you feel that way?
I can't see that far ahead. What I do know is what 100 yards in front of me looks like. But the cool thing now is 100 yards in front of me is almost vertical progress across like product, momentum, the sort of model progress, everything else.
Hello, Logan. It's great to have you here today.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I'm excited about this conversation and excited to dive in.
Okay, to start off, could you briefly introduce yourself and as the product lead for Google AI Studio and Gemini API, what does your role actually involve?
Yeah, that's a great question. My name is Logan Kilpatrick. I lead AI Studio and the Gemini API at Google DeepMind. Both of these products are focused on putting the latest capabilities coming out of Google DeepMind and across Google into the hands of developers, specifically in the AI space. When we launch a new model, Anil Banana or Gemini 2.5 Flash Image, developers come to AI Studio to test out the model, see what it's capable of, and then they go to the Gemini API and actually start building things on top of the API. And my job is helping make sure that that happens successfully. So I have a super cross-functional job of everything from helping craft the go-to-market to what are the product features we build to working super closely with our engineering and model teams to actually build a bunch of this stuff to spending a bunch of time with external developers and understanding what are the things they need from our models and our APIs. I think what gets me most excited is this like breadth of all the stuff that I get to work on, and it's a pleasure.
You used to be at OpenAI before joining Google. What was the key reason behind that move? And what part of Google's vision really spoke to you?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think there's, in many ways, there's so many things that are different about OpenAI and Google. And in many ways, there's a lot of things that are really similar. Like for example, I think like the original incarnation for OpenAI was actually a bunch of the folks there seeing all the work that Demis and folks at Google DeepMind were doing in the early 2014, 2015 era of AI. I think it's been incredible to see DeepMind sort of inspire this like entire generation. Like literally Demis, I was watching The Thinking Game. I don't know if you've seen The Thinking Game, but it's a movie about Demis Hassabis, who's the CEO at DeepMind, and seeing the things that he was thinking about 10 years ago and like all of that literally happening today and like coming to fruition is just super wild. But I think for me personally, it was a chance to go zero to one again. When I joined Google, we had 30,000 developers using the Gemini API. I think we were still early in sort of the life cycle of getting iterations of building the Gemini model and getting to see that scale up to now millions of developers and lots of people building really cool stuff and actually frontier capabilities across the board. Like Gemini is now one of the world's best models at a bunch of multimodal use cases, a bunch of coding and agentic use cases, a bunch of image generation and editing use cases with Gemini 2.5 Flash Image. So lots of progress across all these dimensions. And it's in many ways, like DeepMind feels like a startup, which is really interesting. Like it's inside of the broader Google organization, which is obviously not a startup, but I think DeepMind is definitely operating like a startup these days, which is super fun to be a part of.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Oh, recently on X, you said, I've never been more confident in Google than I am today. What made you feel that way?
Yeah, that's a good question. And so the reply to this tweet was, I find myself saying this to myself more often than not these days. I think to be honest, when I look back a year and a half ago when I joined Google, it was not abundantly clear to me. I think just generally, the challenge with progress is like when you're looking ahead, you can often see your like viewpoint is pretty limited and thus you sort of miss where the slope is going actually. I could see, I was like, okay, I know Google is going to make great models. I know we have all the things we need to make progress, but I could only see 100 yards in front of me and actually 200 yards in front of me, you see straight up and to the right on a slope curve. And I think that was one of the most difficult things. And I think now the interesting thing is like even today it's the same thing. I can't see that far ahead. I don't know what the future looks like. What I do know is what 100 yards in front of me looks like. But the cool thing now is the 100 yards in front of me is almost vertical progress across like product momentum, the sort of model progress, everything else. And like a bunch of these are like for Google now. As you scale up from Google I/O last year, Google was processing like 50 trillion tokens a month. Google I/O this year, we were processing 500 trillion tokens a month, and then last month it was 980 trillion in tokens a month. Wow. So there's this like massive inflection, like growth up and to the right. And these are the types of things that like Google is so well suited to solve, is like this massive infrastructure scale problem. And it just gets me like, there's more and more of these things that just get me so excited about the direction that Google is going in. And yeah, it's a ton of fun to see. It's like, it takes so much human effort to make all this possible, but it's incredible to see.
I'm also looking forward to the Google's progress. In your view, what makes Gemini stands out compared to other language language models. What do you see as its biggest strengths?
Yeah, one of the interesting things about language models in like today's era is that it's this moving target. Other models get better at something, we get better at something, they get better at it, we get better at it, and it's this constant iteration flywheel. I think some of the like, yeah, so I say all that to say like sometimes it changes, we're better at relative to like other folks in the ecosystem. I do think there's been some enduring things. Multimodal is actually one of those, and it ties really well to this, you know, which I think we'll talk about later, Gemini 2.5 Flash Image or Nano Banana, that model. I think part of the story of why that model is so good is because like fundamentally from the first Gemini model that was created, it was created to be a multimodal model. So that was like the original iteration was fully multimodal. There was some really interesting like multimodal out use cases, which weren't publicly available in the initial version of the model, but sort of showed some of the research direction. The reason multimodal was so important to begin with was because this was like the fundamental belief that this was on the path to AGI. The reason that we built multimodal models is because it was a core capability in order to get us to AGI. It's more important than just some new AI capability. It's not, we're not doing it just because it's cool, because it's useful and helpful. Actually, this is a, like multimodal understanding and generation and editing. All of these things are different capabilities that you would expect some like sufficiently intelligent system to be able to do. So as we continue to make progress on it, it's like a clear part of this general story of how we're building AGI, which is interesting.
Is there any particular product built with Gemini that impressed you the most?
Interestingly, and this is a Google version of this, but I don't know if you've, have you tried Notebook LM before?
Oh yeah, yeah, I tried it.
Yeah, so the interesting thing about Notebook LM, and we don't tell this story that much, which I always find funny, but the reason, the thing people comment on the most about Notebook LM is that the scripts, like the two, the podcasters as they're talking to each other, yeah, is so, human-like. Yeah, it's so natural. And so the thing, the funny thing is what makes it so natural is Gemini. It's just a regular Gemini model with a bunch of prompts that's actually like writing the transcript of the two podcast hosts talking to each other. So there's like no secret sauce of, you know, some special system that Google's using to do this. There is an audio model that does the sort of two speakers that's actually available to developers. You could use that audio model right now if you want to. It's available at AI Studio and the Gemini API. But the secret sauce was the prompting that made the host seem so human-like in the conversations, which is just a really interesting story.
The language model and the speaking model is the same model at all fundamental?
Yeah, that's a good question. The text-to-speech model is based on, so we have a Flash and a Pro model. They're based on the same underlying model, but they add some additional stuff to make them like optimized for the audio output use case. So it is like, it's technically two different models, but they have all the same like fundamental stuff behind the scenes.
What's the most important recent update in Gemini API or Google AI Studio? And what kind of new opportunities does it give to developers?
The one that I'm most excited about, and we're leaning into this with this update, is, I don't know if you vibe code. Do you vibe code?
Yeah, I vibe code a lot.
Yeah, yeah, I love that. So we have in AI Studio, we have, there's a build tab on the left-hand side. And if you go to that build tab, we have all these like pre-made AI demo apps. And the cool thing is you can try out the demo apps, you can see what Gemini is capable of. But the best part is that you can directly vibe code and like remix with a prompt, whatever the like base starter app is. So we have like a kind of AI photo editing, like starter template app that we built. And you can just fully customize it in any way. You can go in and edit the code yourself manually. You can prompt to edit the thing. So we're very early in building this vibe coding experience. So it's not perfect. It doesn't do everything, but I think it has a lot of interesting things that we have done and will continue to do around that. So I'm excited. You should play around with it and send me feedback if you have any suggestions.
Oh, okay. I'll try. Lately, Nano Banana has been getting a lot of buzz. How did that project came about? How was it received internally? And how do you imagine it might be used by developer?
Yeah, we shipped the first native image output model earlier this year. So 2.0 Flash, native image generation and editing, I think was the first LLM that had this capability that was available to the world. So we shipped that earlier this year, and the reception was really, really impressive. And this was before OpenAI had shipped the GPT image model. So not a lot of people were like building products around that experience. So after we shipped it, and I think after others in the ecosystem also shipped their stuff, there's been like a whole market that's sort of built around these models. So I think people have figured out a lot more use cases that worked really well that they perhaps weren't building products for in the past because the models just didn't work. They weren't good enough. So I think for this model, it's been sort of a continuation of the progress from earlier this year. So it was the same similar team that was working on it before has like continued to make that model better. And we had a 2.0 Flash version. Now we have a 2.5 Flash version and hopefully have another version in the future. So I think the use cases pieces though that I'm most excited about, it continues to be like prompt based editing. I use lots of like random tools to make images and stuff like that sometimes. And it's really hard as like someone who's like not a professional user of a lot of those tools. I fumble my way through it in a lot of cases. And then this model was, I think, the first one that it just, a lot of these image editing use cases just worked for me. Like I could really just describe what I wanted. Again, it's not perfect. Like the models don't work for certain cases and you still need to use other tools for those. But I think for a lot of the creative use cases I was trying to solve, the model has worked really, really well out of the box, which has been awesome to see that progress from the initial version. I think roughly it was like 4 or 5 months ago to today's version.
What products do you expect using Nano Banana?
Yeah, I think definitely the image editing ones is top of mind. I think we have this like funny demo of like a Polaroid camera picture and you can kind of like do all these iterations of that. That's a fun one that I think I could imagine people doing like lots of like creative use cases. Actually, one of the most timely ones is like interior design. Like I just got this new bookcase in my apartment and I was talking to someone who's giving me design suggestions and they were talking about like curtains and I have a window over here. And I was like, yeah, I'm literally tomorrow, I'm just going to build an app that lets me like customize and like look through a bunch of different curtain options and see what they would actually look like in my space. So I think that's like, both of those are like very universal applications that I think lots of people will benefit from someone building an app around those.
Wow, interesting idea. There's a lot of anticipation around Google's next AI model. Can you give us a small hint about when it might come out or what big improvements we can expect?
No, I won't give any spoilers. but I think lots of focus for a bunch of our models on coding stuff, which I'm really excited about. I think if you look back to like the initial 2.0 model was really focused on sort of agentic use cases. And I think we've continued to double down on that with 2.5 with sort of expanding in coding capabilities as well. And I think those are the two sort of agentic and coding are the two domains that I think people are mostly building stuff around, but there's also a lot of opportunity to like continue to hill climb progress. I think if you actually look at some of the multimodal understanding use cases, the models are actually so good already that it's like hard, like it's actually really tough to make progress on some of those use cases. And I think coding and agentic capabilities are two that I think like there's tons of room for the models to get better and like longer running tasks and stuff like that. So, and I think we sort of directionally showed a lot of this progress with 2.5 DeepThink, which was initially showcased at Google I/O and then we made available to Gemini Ultra subscribers, which sort of uses this like parallel thinking approach and you're able to get a lot more performance. So yeah, I think it has worked especially well for coding use cases and things like that. So I'm excited. I think as a developer, I want models that are better at coding and hopefully we'll get that.
And on a personal note, when you code these days, what tools or tool combos do you use most often? For example, Gemini CLI or Cursor or something?
I'm doing more vibe coding in AI Studio, which is fun. My use case is very niche because I'm mostly building stuff with the Gemini API. I don't build a lot of things that are outside of that, and I probably should. It'd be fun because there's lots of cool things to build. But most of the use cases I do these days are Gemini API focused. In AI Studio, the system message has a bunch of this context already built in. So I can just show up and be like, make me an app that does X, Y, and Z thing. And then it already knows to use Gemini and I don't have to think about it. And it works really well for that use case. But yeah, I switch between all the tools, which is the problem. So I have VS Code and a bunch of the capabilities there. I use Cursor, I use WinServe. I use Gemini CLI every once in a while. I'm not a big CLI fan myself. I grew up using an IDE. So using the CLI feels a bit odd to me in a lot of ways, but all the IDEs I dick around. I use Clone in VS Code sometimes. I played around with RuCode a little bit. So there's lots of cool stuff out there.
With AI moving so quickly, how do you see the future of software development changing? Do you think people will still need to learn coding?
Yeah, I think there's such a premium on learning to code in the future. And I'll give you my thesis for this, which is if the vibe coding thing actually works out and continues, which I think it will, like the models are going to keep getting better at coding, et cetera. So my sort of general thesis is there's going to be 100 million people who come in because of vibe coding and they start building software. The challenge is like how far they can build without actually being able to write code is like a pretty low ceiling. It'll keep going up incrementally higher because AI tools will get better, et cetera, et cetera. But naturally there will always be a stopping point. And this is the beauty of like, of why there'll be so much opportunity for like traditional developers, because at that stopping point, who's going to actually help make the software better? You need humans. Like the human has to come in and take over this sort of vibe coded software creation and continue to make it incrementally better. So I think there's going to be like this massive explosion of people writing software. And because of this massive explosion of software, there's going to be this like huge demand surge for expertise, which is like, if you're a really great developer and you can help five other developers, or you can help someone else like become a developer, it becomes this huge premium. Like, I think this is actually great for you and like showing people how to code and talking about AI progress and all this stuff. Like, there's going to be a huge influx of people who are excited about this direction and are trying to understand what's happening, because that's ultimately the way to get the most value out of the models and AI. So I think it's going to be great for developers. It's also going to be great for everyone else who's like just onboarding into this ecosystem.
And looking ahead of 5 years, what do you think will be the biggest way AI transforms our daily lives and society?
One of the things I'm most excited for is this. There's a couple of product experiences around AI that I think once those land, it'll make it feel much more natural. One of those is like proactiveness. I think the models, like me as the user having to like do all of the outreach to the AI model to get it to do something, I think like doesn't actually work that well. So I think the proactiveness makes a lot of sense, and I think that will help a ton. The personal context, I think, is also useful. Like we live, you know, in some sense, we have all this like all these digital artifacts of our lives. And for the most part, they don't actually create any value. It's like, I have a whole phone filled with emails and text messages and a bunch of other stuff. And like, it's pretty much useless right now. It doesn't really do anything for me. And I think as we get closer to the sort of AI product experience of the future, all that context will be brought in and sort of actioned upon where it's useful. That proactiveness where like the models can be sort of triaging things for you and sort of intentionally outreaching to you and being like, hey, should I do this thing, et cetera. So I think both of those experiences, when they land, it's going to feel like you actually have someone who's helping you get stuff done, versus I think today's AI experiences don't, they're not there yet. So they're definitely helpful for like very specific things, but I don't think they've like crossed the chasm of like truly being a helpful assistant in your everyday life.
Finally, is there any message or advice you'd like to share with developers in Korea and viewers of the Joe Coding Channel?
Yeah. First of all, I was in South Korea probably 2 years ago in Seoul. And it was awesome, and was there meeting with developers. And I think one of the takeaways was there's so much interest and excitement about AI and like so many problems to be solved. And it was clear that like there is an incredible density of super strong developers in Korea who are pushing on all this stuff. So I think like a couple of reactions. One is there's never been a better time to be an engineer and like be a software developer and be a programmer than today. I think the AI moment only makes that more true. And I think specifically like building AI powered applications, there's like so much potential to help solve like everyday, like real world problems, and the breadth and the scope and the level of ambition of what you can solve with today's technology is super. It's like every time a new model comes out, you can be more ambitious, which is what I love about the AI moment, is you can keep sort of leveling up that ambition. And so my advice is like, make sure you keep leveling up that ambition. It's easy to be like, oh, I have this very specific problem, I want to solve this. I think you can keep getting more ambitious as the technology gets better. And then on a practical note, I think if folks like have things that they're trying to build and it's not possible or it doesn't work today, please reach out to us. Like I think I'm on Twitter and X and my email's out there and all that other stuff. We have a developer forum. Like if you want to build cool stuff and if the models actually or the APIs make it so that you can't do that, get in touch with us. We'd love to hear about what those use cases are and would love to help make that stuff possible.
Logan, thank you so much for sharing insights today. I'm really looking forward to seeing what you and the team at Google build next. Thanks again for joining us.
Yeah, this was awesome. Thank you. And I appreciate you taking the time to chat, and hopefully we can vibe code some stuff with Nano Banana together sometime.
Oh, great.
Thank you, guys. Have a great day.
Thanks, Logan.
Thank you.
See ya. Digital life. Digital.